kept saying, you know, you need to keep going with this because this is interesting. Like these deal flows, I've never seen.
Does he guide you?
Yes, he does.
Okay, what advice do you ask from your father? I mean, many people would pay for his advice at this point,
I'm
right?
I'm very lucky.
Yeah, well, I'm curious, what have you ever asked him?
I always ask him to look through the deals before I commit to going on to the second meeting with them. I like to go in an early stage seed round and really participated in the growth of the startup.
And what does he always advise you? I mean, clearly he's left you on your own enough for you to make your own decisions, but he's that guiding hand. Is there anything you can share to the audience that they may take from your father that he's told you in business or in anything?
Well, you just have to fail better because you learn more from your failures than your successes.
He said fail better?
Yes.
What does that mean?
Well, we all learn.
To you.
We all learn from our failures more than our successes, I believe, from my personal experience and from the experiences of all my peers. But the important part is to learn from those failures and move on quickly. You just waste so much time dwelling on those failures that all that productive energy can go into moving into the next step, into being informed to never make those mistakes again.
Yeah, yeah. So that's helped you.
Yes,
would
very
you
much
consider
so.
Yourself a daddy's girl?
I think I'm both.
Both?
Equally
yeah,
both.
Yeah.
I'm close to both.
Okay.
Close.
How would you describe both your parents in terms of their role in your life today?
My mom is definitely my moral compass.
Yes.
And also, you know, in fashion, she's always been like my style icon.
Okay.
And my dad has always been the business mind that I love to pick the brains of.
Okay.
We always send, you know, Bloomberg articles every day,
yes,
Forbes articles every day, and discuss what's going on in the marketplace in today's world.
Yeah. Speaking of style, you also recently invested in it's a UK company. Am I correct?
Yes.
Wherein it's a footwear brand.
Yes.
All right. So would you say this is your second or you've already invested in more after that?
So far, what makes KSR Ventures unique is its focus to developing solutions that are creative for environmental friendly pieces.
Oh, yeah.
And I use and
so
adopt.
You, that's even the mantra of the company.
Yeah, so
you really invest only in, okay, go on.
So my investment philosophy adopts a triple bottom line sustainability framework that evaluates social, environmental, and economic impact.
Yes.
Way beyond valuing traditional financial metrics.
So you're not all about the startup that will make the money.
Exactly. I think each investment contributes to solving an environment and or social challenge in inspiring ways.
Okay, now that's very interesting because you even have a mission, vision statement in your KSR Ventures. What would you consider yourself, a venture capitalist?
I would consider myself a venture capitalist going into the new world of venture capital because there's so much capital around the world, but it's how you advise the startups and how your contribution adds value to their startup.
Okay, you chose a UK-based footwear brand. One would ask why? There are many footwear brands all over the world. So the question would be, how does Katrina Razon make the statement and all right, we're gonna put money in this company? Do you go through meetings? Do you go through studies, FGDs, or are you instinctive?
I would like to do both. I think that trusting your gut feeling is very, very, very important. But also, what was interesting about this investment was that I was a customer of the brand prior to even hearing that they were raising a round for their seed.
Yeah.
And they had reached out to me hearing about my involvement with Wonderfruit and that they heard about my VC firm. So they said, you know, I think you'd be the right cornerstone investment for us because one of the issues in the world is that the fashion industry is one of the biggest pollutants.
Absolutely.
And what they're doing is that they're slowing down the fashion process by using ethically sourced material and sustainable practices in terms of creating the shoes, honing a craftsmanship to those shoes, but also they're timeless classics and they're not trend focused. And those shoes, as a testament from being a customer, they've lasted me all these years and I would never wear another boot.
You can say the name of the boot because it's a company.
The Spirit Boot.
Yeah, because that's the company you invested in. Have you ever lost money?
Yes, definitely, definitely. In the crypto space.
Yeah.
For sure.
What have you learned? I mean, when you lost money, I mean, clearly that was fail better. That. What did you learn from that? I mean, everybody's into crypto now, but what did you realize?
I've learned that crypto is very, 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 very volatile to the price surges, and that even though there'll be companies that say that they're hedging, everyone is vulnerable to the price surges and the price fluctuations. So
yeah.
it's a bit scary at first, but you learn to look at your tangible businesses and realize that, hey,
yeah,
this is what deserves,
you know,
my
many
focus.
20-year-olds could be watching you right now and say, she took up communications, but she sounds so brilliant in business. What can they do? They don't have a father like your father, but how can they learn in a way you've learned very fast?
You just have to put yourself out there. And
okay,
one thing that DJing had taught me was that you can't be shy. You're very vulnerable. You have 200 pairs of eyes looking at you. And it's important to really just be outgoing and be down to earth and introduce yourself to someone in the crowd,
yeah,
because all the best connections are made through social events. And when you meet someone that can contribute to your business or vice versa, it could be very valuable to you. So I really, really owe that to my festival background and the DJing career and having to lose my fear of public speaking and of being a stranger in a room full of people I've never met before, because you end up losing out on so much when you don't put yourself out there.
Okay, now when it comes to the party scene, the music scene, you know, I can imagine parents fearing the drug scene as well. But clearly, I would have to say it exists, but you go through it because you're wearing a suit in the morning, you're investing, you're doing this, you're doing that. Where did you get the core, the strength to actually, you know, not lose it?
Well, when I saw a lot of my contemporary,
yes,
DJ peers who are much older, who are already in their 40s, and I've seen how it's really affected their life, the traveling, and they don't necessarily do drugs, but everyone around them does. And it gets to them because they're,
yeah,
in their heads, they're like, everyone in the clubs are getting younger and I'm getting older.
Yeah, yeah.
And I hate to see this.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
So you really have to just draw the line and really just listen to your body and just really, really, really be aware of your surroundings as well, because there are other things that can happen in a crowded space that,
yes,
you know,
yes,
that can,
yes,
be quite
yeah,
scary. But you really have to have a strong head on your shoulder and,
yeah,
be strong.
Okay, what's quite interesting is a little bit of history here. You know, some parents may not have to panic after finding out that at one point you were a video game addict growing up. Were you really?
Yes.
Or that's an exaggeration?
No, yes. My mom was actually the one who got me
worried
into video games.
She did?
No, she did, yes.
Because I worry that my son is into video games, and reading your bio, I was like, okay, if my son ends up to be like Enrique Razon, I'm not worried. It says you were a video game addict. You even applied to join a Nickelodeon game show.
Yes, Legends of the Hidden
okay,
Temple.
Can you explain that? So you learned something from video games?
Yes, because when I was growing up, my mom actually really helped me learn how to read, because she's the gamer in the family.
Really?
And so she would play Resident Evil and give me the walkthrough, like the cheat book, and say, read this out. And I'd be sitting there terrified, stuttering as I'm trying to like figure out the instructions while she's there like battling zombies and snakes. Like, my toys growing up were not Barbie. Toys growing up were snakes, zombies, vampires.
And there was no panic at any point, Katrina, you have to stop the video games, that's too much.
Well, the panics, there was like a mild panic,
yeah,
when I would get nightmares at night.
Okay.
And my dad said, maybe you should not play Resident Evil so much. So my mom got into the RPG, like more fantasy-oriented games.
Yes,
but one,
yes,
thing I really learned about the video games is strategy and,
okay,
how to be creative with problem solving, for example.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. So did it help you in school? I mean, just looking back, because video games are the big issue now. You have kids that live on PS4. I mean, they're on their iPad.
I think it's also what it means for screen time. I think,
okay,
now with today's generation, they're the first generation to grow up with,
yes,
in the digital
they're
world.
They're called natives.
Yes, exactly.
Yeah, yeah.
So they're they're the first ones that are going to be using it when they're much, much younger at an unprecedented rate.
Yeah.
And I think that as parents, it's important to limit screen time as the brain is developing.
Yeah, yeah. You also love theater. Why didn't you ever pursue being an actress?
Because I just loved studying it and I loved directing it so much.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And as much as I loved acting and the way that it taught me to lose my fear of public speaking, and it taught me how to lose my fear of communicating with strangers and making new friends. Because